The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
John the Baptist saw Jesus coming towards him and said, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. He is the one of whom I said, 'A man is coming after me and ranks ahead of me because he existed before me.' I did not know him, but the reason why I came baptizing with water was that he might be known to Israel." John testified further, saying, "I saw the Spirit come down like a dove from heaven and remain upon him. I did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, 'On whoever you see the Spirit come down and remain, he is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit.' Now I have seen and testified that he is the Son of God." The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Come, Holy Spirit, come by the most powerful means of the Immaculate Heart of Mary, your well-beloved spouse. Today, we live in a time where there's chaos everywhere. Just turn on the news, you'll see it. And in that, we need the Holy Spirit. We need that grace in our life. We need that peace, that joy, that love that only can come from God to settle us down, to settle us in, and to follow him. Jesus, Mary, also, we have to see them as archetypes, as what God is teaching can happen to us. If you look at Jesus' life and that anointing of the Holy Spirit, we see that visually within the gospel when we read it, this dove descending upon Jesus and remaining. How do we, as Christians, as followers of Christ, how do we receive that? How do we know that? How do we live that in our lives? Well, we know Mary, and I've talked about the seven wounds of Mary, the seven dolors. Her life, again, is an archetype for the wounds that we get in our life, right? And it could be from childhood. It could be a wound of abandonment. It could be a wound of addiction. It could be whatever it may be. We are wounded in spirit. And what happens is Satan tries to control those particular wounds, which end up in sin and end up in our destruction. But if those wounds are given back to God, if they are sanctified like Mary's was, she becomes the font of the Holy Spirit. The seven gifts of the Holy Spirit flows from her heart because she was overshadowed by the power of the Most High, and the Holy Spirit anointed her when the child Jesus was the conception of the child Jesus. That never left her. But through her life, she was wounded. And God was opening up for us a vessel of grace for that same Spirit throughout her life to flow on the world. So when she was brought up in the coronation and crowned Queen of Heaven and Earth, what happens is that Spirit flows in the world from those seven wounds from our heart. When we start to look at ourselves like that, when we start to look at our woundedness, our struggle, God can do so much through us because of how wounded we are, how Satan has taken his shots, how the things in our life that really are painful, that struggle, can be redeemed. It can be turned around. And God said through Paul, where grace abounds, or where sin abounds, grace abounds even more. So when it's surrendered and given to God, it becomes an unbelievable fruit of God through the Holy Spirit. Let me explain a little bit. I talk about the mystical pathway all the time. It's the thought pattern that we have. If it's negative, if it's You know, and maybe we see someone, we have a negative thought about them, or we judge them, or we have a sin of gossip, which is the manifestation of that judgment, right? So it comes into our mind, the temptation to our heart, moves our emotion, and then out of our body. Same way God uses that inspiration, love, and then love to our children, to our grandchildren. We love through that same pathway. Satan tries to clog that up, that pathway up. He wants us to be angry. He wants us to be fearful. He wants us in all these negative emotions, right? So what are those gifts of the Holy Spirit? How do we obtain them? Well, when sin is gone, when we go to confession, that little box back there is the confessional, by the way. And when we do that, we have to go to confession, confess our sins, and ask for God's mercy. That clears the board. But what happens is we still have wounds on our heart. Could be whatever wound it may be, addiction, it was abandonment. We could have had something awful happen to us in our life where we're holding that, and it is our life in a sense. It's always on our mind. It hurts. And what sin sometimes is the medication of that wound. We're trying to feel better, but the thing is we're doing it in the wrong way. So when we go to confession, what we're in a perfect position to be healed of that woundedness. But we have to understand the woundedness, because God does not throw his pearls to swine, right? If he doesn't show you the woundedness, we're going to trample all over his blessing. So we pray for that. Lord, show me my woundedness. Let me know how I need to heal. And he shows us that. And then we bring that to communion in the state of grace. Now we have the author of life. We have the creator of the universe, the cosmos, coming into us and able to heal that wound, penetrate all of that, because we're free from sin. But yet all that remains is that wound. And he finds that resting place right there. And he pours his precious blood into it. And all of a sudden it's shored up like this. That scar is there. That scar tissue is there. And what happens at that point, right? We become free from that temptation. That thing bothering us. And we're not sitting right now, right away when we have the thought. That's the idea. That's what we're here for, is to have the grand physician heal us of those wounds, of those pettinesses, of those sins, of those struggles. So my brothers and sisters, the seven gifts of the Holy Spirit are so important in that, because they are the activators of our life, right? What are they? The first are with the mind, wisdom, knowledge, and understanding, right? Fear of the Lord, which we need in this world, because sin has been relegated to habit and things that they show on TV. I mean, sometimes I'll be watching TV and they'll take the Lord's name in vain, right? How many times do we see that? Right away I'm like, praise you, Lord Jesus. You know, I have to say it out loud to counteract it. Otherwise, it gets really wonky in my head. I can't watch stuff like that. But, so fear of the Lord, piety, counsel, fortitude, right? Those are the things that we need the most in our life. Jesus has that. He is the source and the summit. Everything is encapsulated in him, and we see that in a visual from the gospel today. So how do we maintain that life of peace and joy and love? First of all, we hit that box in the back, right? We ask God for his mercy, and then we ask for our wounds to be healed. We ask those things that were traumatic in our life to be healed. Lord, heal them, especially when we receive the Eucharist. Best time to do it, right? And then we go out and we pray to the Holy Spirit, and we ask him to fill our lives, to fill our hearts, to fill our spirits, so that we can act in that way in the world. And then what comes out of us is that mystical pathway becomes pure. We get inspiration, we get love, and we're sharing that love with the people around us. And they look at us and say, something's different about you. Why are you this way? And they're attracted to the peace. And then you just point them back to St. Mary's or St. John's and say, go there, hit the box. Hit the box, right? That's what it's about. But when we start to understand what God is trying to do with us, when
we understand the faith and how it works, then we step forward. And I have this image that stuck in my mind a couple days ago, and it's when we're focused on Jesus, it's almost like a gravitational pull, where we get sucked into that, and we love God so much, and we're starting to move in that direction, we stay focused on Him, all this stuff is going to fall away. Even our bodies fall away at one point, right? And death. But all the sin, all the distraction, all this stuff falls away. But we have to ask for that focus on Christ, that discipleship, that love of Christ, that desire to please God. And when we have that, when it's given to us, nothing can stop you. Nothing can separate you from the love of God. Let us stand in prayer.